On November 12, 1999, the roller coaster with the longest drop in the world was announced. It would hold the title for just 3 months, with a company that made it going bankrupt just a couple of years later. A company that would independently only make 3 roller coasters that have a huge impact on the industry.
The extreme smoothness of the ride experience was designed by coaster makers Gio Vannola of Switzerland.
Goliath, a top-rated steel coaster, reaches 240 feet into the air and drops 255 feet.
The sheer size of Goliath instills fear in these veteran rail junkies.
In the early 1980s, when Gio Vannola started making roller coasters for other companies such as Intamin, first with Vertigarama in Argentina, and later with multiple bobsled coasters, the nearly 100-year-old company would set out on a brand new path, one that would ultimately lead to its downfall. For 95 years, the steel manufacturing company had built power stations, water storage tanks, ski lifts, and even submarines. But this new direction would prove challenging. After Z-Force opened, Gio Vannola continued to have success as a subcontractor for Intamin. With the nearly 10 coasters they had manufactured as a subcontractor, many of which would include firsts for the coaster experience. With the help of 2 of Gio Vannola's engineers, they designed the box-style track that would become famous later for a different coaster design duo, B&M. Wait, wrong B&M. That joke was for the UK watchers. Even when Walter Bolliger and Claude Mavillard left the company to form their own in 1987 and used that box-style track designed at Gio Vannola with slight modifications for themselves, that track would continue to remain a staple for Gio Vannola subcontracted roller coasters. After Z-Force, the track would be seen on multiple stand-up roller coasters like Shockwave, and the company would continue to create rides such as Disney's Indiana Jones roller coaster at Euro Disney, Skull Mountain at Great Adventure, and Lightning Bolt at MGM Grand Adventures. Not only did they provide parts for coasters, but also entire flat rides. Business was going well, and they wanted to forge their own path rather than just subcontract for Intamin, who were working on creating their own track without the need for Gio Vannola. In 1998, Gio Vannola Amusement Rides Worldwide was founded to sell, design, and manufacture their own attractions. With a new in-house design team, the company would offer the full package: design, fabrication, and construction. They got started right away, announcing they will be working on 2 roller coasters for 1999. Their very first to open would take inspiration from the breakout hit for B&M, an inverted coaster debuting in 1999 at South Africa's Gold Reef City. The very first Gio Vannola sold roller coaster, Anaconda, the largest roller coaster in Africa. The park was hoping that by adding more coasters, they would broaden the appeal for international visitors. Gio Vannola offered both a 2-seat and 4-seat version of the inverted coaster, and each could use either a traditional chain lift or a launch. Gold Reef City opted to go for the 2-seat version with chain lift. The trains would feature 2 riders side by side in longer trains than the normal B&M 4 across versions. While Batman the Ride mostly featured theming during the queue, Anaconda would weave scenery and theming throughout. Anaconda's ride experience begins with the drop taking a left-hand dive through a boulder, which looks like you will barely fit through. The track flies over water and sits atop the park's River Ride Rapids. While similar to Batman the Ride, with the exact same inversions, there were some differences. It began the same, with a loop followed by a 0G roll, though this one was more spread out than the B&M version, offering a lengthier span of weightlessness. A second loop follows, but from here on out, the ride would differentiate itself from Batman. The track curls around a large rock and mining cavern, like, you guessed it, a snake. The downward spiral continues through the rocks right into the double corkscrew, heading into a final counterclockwise helix. The first coaster made solely and sold by Gio Vannola was top quality. A forceful, smooth ride that no matter where you sat offered incredible views. a beautiful roller coaster in a beautiful park. Giovanola had taken Batman the Ride to the next level. The second roller coaster planned for 1999 would be in the US, a different kind of beast, a hypercoaster, located at Six Flags Magic Mountain.
Six Flags Magic Mountain set out to build Goliath, the steel giant that would be the first coaster to bring in the new millennium. It would tower 255 feet above the earth with one of the world's tallest drops. To be designed by the Swiss ride manufacturing company, Giovanola, this 85-mile-per-hour scream machine would become one of the fastest traditional coasters anywhere in the world.
Originally planned to be called Millennia, it would be the world's tallest, fastest, and longest roller coaster, and would be painted many different colors to appear to be many different coasters as it ran through different themed areas of the park, each with elements specific to the surroundings. However, the park delayed the ride to 2000. Giovanola warned that they would not be able to guarantee it would still keep its records, as they were working on other coasters that would beat it themselves, rumored to go to one of the King's parks. It didn't matter though, because Intamin and Cedar Point were working on something that would be much bigger, Millennium Force. Not only a coaster that would take the records, but force Millennia to change its name. Millennium Force by Intamin would be announced on July 22nd, 1999, and when opened, would become the complete circuit tallest roller coaster in the world. In November 1999 at IAAPA, Magic Mountain would announce their new mega coaster, now called Goliath. This would be the park's 13th roller coaster. With it reaching heights of 255 feet, Giovanola's warning was right. However, Goliath would be the tallest roller coaster in the world, along with the fastest at 85 miles per hour when it opened. Well, for 3 months. When asked why it would be called Goliath, the park stated because it's the name of a legendary giant, and this ride would be a legendary giant. Oh, and also because a lot of people call large coasters Goliaths, a name that would go on to be reused by Six Flags at multiple parks.
We started planning Goliath in 1998 to add to our collection of unique ride experiences here.
The park hoped the new attraction would boost attendance to the record level set in 1994. With a loose Mayan ruin theme located in the Goliath Plaza, the ride, designed with help from Werner Stengel, opened on February 11th, 2000. Originally, the ride had an issue when Giovanola had made the final piece of track a few inches too short, but this was quickly fixed with a replacement track. The 3-month, longest and fastest complete circuit coaster would leave the station up the 235-foot high lift hill before heading down the 255 drop into a 120-foot long tunnel, reaching that top speed of 85 miles per hour before heading through multiple turns and hills on the 4,500 feet of track. Even though the ride was short-lived in its records, it became iconic, standing above the previous highest drop roller coaster in the park, Colossus. On February 10th, Six Flags invited as many people named David as they could to come and get unlimited free rides on Goliath. In the biblical account of David and Goliath, it took a slingshot and a stone to slay the mighty giant. Pelting rain couldn't stop the hundreds of Davids who showed up from conquering Goliath. At Magic Mountain, in celebration of the new millennium, a huge wedding was hosted on February 14th, 2000, Valentine's Day, for 1,000 couples. Most of them were married in the parking lot, though a select few exchanged vows by taking the plunge down the drop of Goliath, with two ministers standing on the catwalk. Newspapers report that the wedding reception included cake. When asked how they felt before saying I do and taking the drop, one of the couples just said, "Aw, man." Yeah. Goliath was a huge success, and while it only held the record for 3 months, it increased the park's attendance, was hugely popular, and well received. Before the end of the year even came, Six Flags and Giovanola announced what was next. This time for Six Flags Over Texas's 40th anniversary, a Titan.
From the Texas of old to today's Texas pride, from the smile of a child to the thrill of the ride, this is the star that stands alone.
third Geo Vanola coaster would be very similar to Goliath, with the same drop height but a slightly taller lift hill. Reported to cost $12 million and using £500,000 of steel, it began just as Goliath did. But one thing would set this ride apart: the extra 600 feet of track featuring not one, but now two intense helixes. These helixes can be so intense that many people report blacking out in this section. The ride opened in the Texas section of the park on April 27th, 2001. At this point though, Geo Vanola was struggling. Once again, they had opened an iconic, fun, and intense coaster. Titan, however, would be their last, and the cause for the company's final struggling years and demise. The three rides that opened by the company were not all that was originally planned. Geo Vanola had aspirations much bigger and offered a full selection of coaster types for sale, and even introduced brand new ones, such as the tilt coaster called the Terra Tilter. This was shown at the IAPA Expo in the year 2000. Sadly, none of them were ever made. They were also involved in the creation of a second coaster at Gold Reef City, Tower of Terror. This coaster had so many problems, the company denied even being involved in making it. I'm sure this did not help the company financially either. We have a whole expedition on that ride though. The company's troubles would begin in the year 2000 while constructing Titan. They had underestimated the cost of adding an extra helix to the ride, which Six Flags had requested. This resulted in Geo Vanola Amusement Division losing as much as 7 million francs. This loss caused the company to struggle to pay its 220 employees' wages. The same year, due to faulty welds, a hydraulic penstock created by the non-amusement division of Geo Vanola at a power station failed, causing more financial issues, and what was worse, another tragic incident when an armoured well broke, resulting in the death of three people. These failures added another 2 million to the already 7 million debt, along with the incidents tarnishing the image of the company. The separate Geo Vanola Amusement Rides Worldwide division of the company ended in 2001, filing for bankruptcy, the same year that that mega coaster had opened in Texas. The parent company would restructure and file for bankruptcy protection. With some new leaders in place, the company was confident they could recover. They did not. From February 7th, 2002, the company was now a restructured real estate and equity company, owning the land of their factory and now known as Geo Vanola Technologies. All remaining assets were moved over to the new company or liquidated. In 2004, Geo Vanola Tech officially declared bankruptcy and ceased to exist, ending a 116-year-old history, citing a tough economy, failure at a Texan theme park, along with the well incident as the reasons. Old-fashioned management, financial issues and miscalculations led to the demise of what could have been one of the most competitive ride companies in the world. The three rides they opened were a huge success, along with being just great attractions that regularly featured in the top lists of coasters, bringing many people to visit their parks. Creating great rides though was not enough, and a future with many more Geo Vanola coasters never came to be. That isn't to say the impact they left on the industry was small, however. From a modest blacksmith shop in 1888, they had evolved over the years and created many coasters for Intamin, without really getting any of the credit. They had introduced the box-style track to the world, they were the place Walter and Claude began their journey and went on to create B&M, and they also worked on the world's largest travelling inverted coaster. Today, when you look at the many record-breaking B&M roller coasters around the world, stand back and remember that it all started at the bankrupt Geo Vanola. For a short time, Geo Vanola were a titan in the industry. Who knows how the industry would look today if Geo Vanola was still in it. For a company that existed for over 100 years, they paved the way for bigger and better things. Thank you so much for watching this episode of Expedition Extinct. If you enjoyed it, make sure you subscribe to join the expedition and follow us on Twitter and Instagram for updates on upcoming episodes. A special thank you to our patrons for supporting the channel. We will see you next time. From the Texas.